Good morning. It's good to see so many of you joining us here this morning to hear the analysis from our experts on a budget that held a few surprises. My name is Tim Stovold. I'm one of the tax partners at Moore Kingston Smith. Slightly out of breath from sorting out the IT issues. I'm sure most of you are familiar with who we are. I can see lots of regular names on the attendee list. But for those of you who don't know who we are, Moore Kingston Smith is a top 10 audit, tax and advisory firm with businesses across all industries, not-for-profit organisations, as well as private clients. We're part of Moore Global, an international network with presence in over 100 countries. Earlier this week, we heard from the Chancellor that a technical recession would be avoided, inflation was coming under control, and energy prices were falling. So far, so good. But he resisted calls to reverse the increase in the corporation tax rate and did nothing to address the problem of fiscal drag where we've got frozen personal tax thresholds. As ever, the devil's in the details, so I'm delighted to be joined by my fellow partners, Nick Blundell and Claire Roberts. Nick is a specialist in all things relating to corporate and business taxes, and Claire is one of our private client experts. My job would normally be to cover employment tax related issues, but the budget was a bit light on that area, so I'm going to be keeping an eye on the Q&A and making sure I ask the most difficult questions to Claire and Nick. So without further ado, and once again, thanks for bearing with us, I'm going to hand over to Claire to get started.
Thanks, Tim, and good morning, everyone. So I'm going to talk through some of the personal tax changes that were announced on Wednesday, and also cover some of the changes that have previously been announced that will be coming in from the 6th of April 2013. So the two big announcements as far as personal tax were concerned related to changes to the pensions regime. So changes were widely expected and trailed in advance, but the extent of these changes, I think came as a surprise to many. So the surprise announcement was that the lifetime allowance is to be abolished. So from the 6th of April 2023, the lifetime allowance charge will be removed and it will then be completely abolished from the 6th of April 2024. So the current lifetime allowance is £1,073,100 and it's the maximum amount that individuals can save into a pension pot without triggering income tax charges on the excess. So as it stands, once you breach that allowance, any excess benefits are taxed at 55% to the extent that you take those benefits as a lump sum and 25% if you take those benefits as pension income. So from 6th of April 2023, that limit no longer applies and essentially you can save as much as you want into your pension, it's not capped. Now, the rationale behind this move is essentially to encourage the over 50s back to work, particularly senior NHS doctors, where it's believed that the main driver that they're reducing their hours or leaving the workforce is because of these high pension tax charges. So there are mixed views on whether this will achieve the desired effect or whether it will simply encourage those to save more and retire early. But nevertheless, good news for anyone who's nearing or has breached that 1 million allowance. So as always, as Tim said, the devil is in the detail and this change does come with a big caveat. That for most people, the maximum amount that they will now be able to draw tax-free when they commence their pension will be limited to 25% of the current lifetime allowance, which is a figure of £268,275. So that will apply for most people, unless you have lifetime allowance protection already in place, which will entitle those people to still take that higher lump sum. And any amounts taken in excess of the £268,275 will be taxed now at your marginal rate of income tax, as opposed to the flat rate of 55%, which applies now. Now, there will be various people that hold forms of lifetime allowance protection, which essentially allowed you to protect the value of your pension pot and retain a lifetime allowance at a higher previous historic rate prior to its reduction, which it has been reduced on several occasions since its reduction in 2006. So, ordinarily, where you have those protections in place, you're not able to make further contributions to a scheme without losing that protection. So on the face of it now, with these changes, you can make further contributions, a benefit potentially of tax relief of up to 45% on those additional contributions. But then on the flip side, you then risk losing your protection and you're then limited to a tax-free lump sum of £268,275 when your current entitlement may currently be much higher. So I think the key thing here, if you are considering making any further contributions, please do seek advice from a financial advisor. The rules are hideously complicated. We don't yet have all the detail on how they're going to operate. So if you get it wrong, it could clearly be very costly. So please do seek advice before you take any action post 6th of April.
Claire, just before you move on to the next slide, we've had one question in. So if somebody's already breached the lifetime allowance and has been drawing a pension and been paying the 25% tax surcharge, I suppose one point was, will they get any of that tax back? And secondly, when will it be abolished if they carry on drawing the pension in that way?
Well, we haven't heard anything in respect of people that have previously paid that charge. So unfortunately, I think tough luck for those individuals. Sorry, what was the second part?
And if they carry on drawing their pension above the lifetime allowance, when will the 25% be abolished?
I don't know the answer.
So the 25% surcharge on drawing a pension above the lifetime allowance, as far as we're concerned, if you carry on drawing that pension past 6th of April, that will no longer be paid. So the payment will come out without a tax charge. Sorry, I probably wasn't very clear in the question. Right, carry on, Claire, sorry.
Okay, so the other announcement relating to the pension regime was the increase in the annual allowance. So we did expect this change because it was trailed in advance. So that has increased from 40,000 to £60,000 per tax year. And that's from 6th of April, 2023. So that's the maximum of the maximum amount of tax relief savings that you can make in a tax year. And any excess contributions over that amount are subject to tax at your marginal rate. So currently you can carry forward unused allowances from the previous three tax years, and that is expected to remain in place. So you still can continue to do that. Now, it doesn't end there. There are some quite complicated rules for higher earners. And currently, the amount of the annual allowance is tapered if your income is above 240,000. And it's reduced, the annual allowance is reduced by £1 for every £2 over that £240,000 limit, down to a minimum allowance of £4,000. But that income threshold and the minimum tapered annual allowance will both increase from the 6th of April 2023. And the income level at which the tapered annual allowance kicks in will be increased to 260,000, and the minimum tapered annual allowance will be increased to 10,000. I'll just quickly skip to the next slide just to demonstrate how this has changed in recent years. So the tapering now will apply for the income bracket of people with earnings between 260,000 and 360,000. And it will mean now that those earning above 360,000 will be limited to making contributions of £10,000 per year. At the moment, that maximum limit is 312,000. Going back quickly. Similarly, the money purchase limit for those who have access their defined contribution savings, that will also increase to 10,000. So pretty generous changes to the tax rate and pensions regime. I think welcome news for many, but particularly for our higher earners.
There's a good question coming. If you've ceased to make contributions to your pension as you'd reached your pension pot limit, but you want to start to pay in again, will you be able to rely on the carry forward from the past 3 years? Can you carry forward those unused allowances from the past 3 years that you haven't used because you'd stopped making contributions?
As long as you were a member of that scheme in those previous 3 years, then it's expected that you will be able to continue to carry forward those
allowances. Yeah. So, I mean, in practical terms, although you'd need the income to achieve this, you could carry forward three lots of 40,000 and pay in 60,000 next year. So that's what, 180,000 of pension contribution, if my sums are correct. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there's some potentially very large contributions that can be made next tax year that weren't being made because of the lifetime allowance. This is a massive change.
Yeah, definitely. Okay, so aside from the pension changes, there were no real major personal tax announcements, as the majority changes were announced back in November in the autumn statement. So as a reminder of the thresholds and rates that will apply from the 6th of April 2023. So we already knew that the personal allowance and the high rate threshold are frozen until April 2028. So that's 12,570 for the personal allowance and 50,270 for the higher rate threshold. Those limits equally apply for the lower earnings limits and upper earnings limit for national insurance contributions. And ultimately, over the next few years, this is where we're going to see an income tax squeeze for those that are getting pushed into paying higher rates of tax, particularly as inflation pushes up wages. But one change that we will see from the 6th of April 2023 is that reduction in the additional rate threshold to 125,140. And if you remember, that oddly specific number is the number that it is, because that's the limit at which the personal allowance is completely withdrawn. So it does mean if you're in that bracket of 125,140 to 250,000, you will pay an extra 5%. Your income in that bracket, and also remember that you will lose your eligibility for the personal savings allowance, which is the tax-free allowance for savings income. So if you are going to be brought into that additional rate for the first time, you will now have to pay tax on your interest income. So there is still a window of opportunity to plan here before 6th of April 2023, and if you are in that bracket and the extent that you can, and you could think about accelerating some income into the current tax year, such that you'll have more income tax at 40% rather than 45% in the next tax year. And in terms of rates, we were seeing no changes there. They will remain as they are. So you've got the main rates of 20, 40, 45, and the more obscure rates of 8.75, 33.75. 39.35 for dividend income. So one change, again, that we knew was coming down the track is the change to the dividend allowance. So that will be reduced to £1,000 from 6th of April 2023 and halved again to £500 from April 2024. So inevitably, this will mean that, you know, more individuals will be required to register for self-assessment and report that dividend income, particularly perhaps pensioners that supplement their pension with dividend income. So just a word of warning to keep an eye on that. And given that dividends are tax-free within an ISA, something to think about in terms of perhaps selling dividends that are in your own name and buying them back in an ISA to make sure that income is exempt going forward. So capital gains tax, there's always a lot of speculation in the run-up to the budget about whether rates will go up, but thankfully we didn't see any change there. So the current rates will continue to apply. So we've got the rates of 10 and 20% at the main rate, and the rates for residential property will be 18 and 28%. Again, no changes to the rules for business asset disposal relief, which was previously entrepreneurs relief, and for qualifying gains, they will remain to be taxed at 10% up to the lifetime allowance of 1 million. But what we will see change from the 6th of April is the reduction to the annual exemption for capital gains tax. So it's effectively being halved to £6,000 from 6th of April 2023 and halved again to £3,000 from the 6th of April 2024. So again, to the extent that you can accelerate any disposals to pre-5th of April to crystallise capital gains now, then you should think about doing that. It could potentially save £1,764 if you can accelerate those disposals into this tax year rather than next. So one measure that we did know that was coming down the track and will be legislated in the 2023 finance bill is the extension of the period in which no gain, no loss transfers can be made between couples that are separating or divorcing. So as it stands, couples that are separating, divorcing, the no gain, no loss treatment for capital gains tax applies only in the tax year of separation. And thereafter, any transfers between the couple are taxed as a normal disposal for capital gains tax at market value, essentially. So the change that we're seeing here is that that period will be extended. So from the 6th of April 2023, the no gain, no loss transfer rules will apply for a further 3 years from the tax year of separation, and the same treatment will apply to assets transferred as part of a formal divorce agreement. As an extension to these rules, a spouse or civil partner that's left the family home but has retained an interest in it can claim principal private residence relief when it's sold. And for those that have transferred their interest in their former home to their ex-spouse or civil partner, and they're entitled to receive a percentage of the proceeds when the home's eventually sold, they will also be able to apply the same tax treatment to those proceeds that it would have been available when they transferred their original interest to their home, to the former spouse. So much needed, welcome changes there, which will no doubt ease the pressure and stress for what must already be a difficult time for these couples. I won't say minor change, but something to bear in mind for capital gains tax. So where you have a chargeable gain or loss on a conditional contract, the date of disposal is the date the contracts are exchanged. Now, where that applies and the conveyance or transfer of that asset occurs 6 months after the end of the tax year in which the disposal takes place, the time limits for notifying HMRC and the time limits for HMRC being able to assess that chargeable gain will now be by reference to the tax year in which the asset is conveyed or transferred, rather than the tax year of disposal. And this has been introduced to close what is a perceived loophole and where there's a delay between completion of the contract and the conveyance of the asset. And essentially it will allow HMRC more time to assess the tax due. And that will apply to assets disposed of on or after the 6th of April 2023 for individuals and the 1st of April 2023 for companies. Inheritance tax. So despite endless calls for reform in this area, we didn't see any major changes here. So we already knew that the mill rate bans are frozen until April 2028. So that's 325,000 for the general mill rate band and 175,000 for the residence mill rate band. And the limit at which that residence mill rate band tapers away will continue to be £2 million. So one change that we did see, however, in Wednesday's budget was a restriction to the scope of agricultural property relief and woodlands relief for inheritance tax, both of which allow you to pass on qualifying assets to the next generation tax-free. So that will now be restricted to property in the UK and any property located outside the UK in the Channel Islands, EEA and the Isle of Man will be treated the same as other property located outside the UK. So probably the measure that's quite limited in its application, but worth mentioning. And in a similar vein, various charitable tax reliefs will also be restricted to UK charities and community amateur sports clubs. So these changes were effective from Budget Day on the 15th of March and will apply UK-wide. There is a transitional period until April 2024 for EU and EEA charities. That's already, that's cut off the end there of that slide. But those charities that already have been accepted by HMRC as qualifying for tax relief, there is a transitional period for those. Trust and estate. So again, quite a small measure in terms of the simplification of reporting requirements here. So from the 2024 tax year, trusts and estates receiving income of less than £500 will no longer need to pay any tax. Similarly, The beneficiaries of UK estates will not have to pay any tax on income paid out to them if it's within that £500 limit. And discretionary trusts, which lose the starting rate band, will lose the starting rate band of £1,000, and effectively anything over that £500 limit will now be taxed at the trust rates. So again, quite a small measure, but I think a welcome simplification for low income trusts and estates. And I haven't done a slide on this because it's not strictly tax related, but I thought I would just mention childcare support that the Chancellor announced. So he will increase the availability of free childcare and to offer up to 30 hours of free childcare for every child over the age of 9 months for 38 weeks a year. Now, as you would expect, this can't come in immediately because the childcare system will be completely overwhelmed. So this will be a phased introduction. So from April 2024, there will be 15 free hours of childcare for two-year-olds. From September 2024, we'll see that extended to 15 hours of free childcare for children from 9 months old up to 3 years old. And then only in from the 30th September 2025, will that full 30 hours a week for children aged 9 months and over be available for eligible working parents. So welcome news for parents, and I thought it would be of wider interest to some parents listening, but it will come in quite slowly. But that's the extent of my knowledge on that measure. And on that note, I'll hand over to Nick to talk about perhaps some more interesting corporate and business tax measures that were announced.
Thanks, Claire. Just before we move on, Tim, was there anything else on the personal tax measures before we press on?
There's one that's just come in on childcare, which I'm going to answer in the chat, because I'm just going to need to check a couple of points on it. So Nick, you carry on. If we've got time at the end, we might go back to childcare, because it, as Claire says, it does apply to quite a lot of people. So corporate tax and corporate and business tax, go ahead.
Thanks, Tim. And yes, hi everyone. As Tim mentioned earlier, I'm Nick Blundell. I'm a corporate tax partner here at MKS, and delighted to be talking to you about the corporate measures that were in the budget. Some of which were already announced, but sort of confirmed, and a couple of new measures as well. So for the amount that's been going on for the past 2 years. With changes in prime ministers and chancellors and so on, we would be forgiven for forgetting actually that the increase to corporation tax to 25% that comes in a few weeks' time on the 1st of April was actually announced 2 years ago in 2021 and was legislated for 2 years ago. And despite all the will they won't they from the various prime ministers and chancellors that we've had, that has actually never changed. So from the 1st of April, the corporation tax rate increases from 19% to 25%. And for quite some years now, we've had just a flat rate of 19%. But this sees the reintroduction, I should say, of a small profits rate. So if you have taxable profits of £50,000 or below, you will stay on that 19% rate. And if you have profits of £250,000 or above, as a corporate, you will be paying tax of 25% on the full amount. It's worth mentioning. So effectively, what that means is that your profits between £50,000 and £250,000 are effectively taxed for each pound at 26.5%. So there's a sort of nasty sting, actually, if you look at it on a slab rate basis. That if, for example, you've got profits of £150,000, then the 100 over 50,000 is actually taxed at 26.5%. But that is now finally coming in on the 1st of April. It's worth putting in a bit of context, and I've got these two slides that show that the UK is still it's kind of from being a very competitive tax regime for corporates and veering towards tax haven status, although it's putting itself, I suppose, in the middle of the pack, really. And there's still quite a few countries that have higher tax rates than it, but still quite a few which is higher than. I've highlighted the United States there because effectively the United States, whilst it has a federal rate of 21%, by the time you include state taxes, it will almost always still have an effective rate of above 25%. And I have mentioned in sort of Irish green, if you like, for St. Patrick's Day today, but the importance of that our differential now In the UK, between a rate of 25% and the Irish rate of 12.5%. That is obviously making companies like AstraZeneca think about where to build their pharmaceutical plants with them. The CEO recently mentioning the what he described as the UK's discouraging tax rate going forward. So that will be interesting to see how all this plays out from the point of view of the competitiveness of the UK. It is worth bearing in mind some context though, and Jeremy Hunt last weekend before the budget was very keen to mention that you shouldn't just look at the standard rate of corporation tax, which is big, probably as big as hint that we were going to stick with 25%, but that all the other sort of incentives that are available effectively to lower your effective tax rate and other things about doing business in the UK. And I've listed some of those there, and we'll come on shortly to talk about the changes in the capital allowances regime, which will reduce the tax base for many capital intensive businesses. So moving on to capital allowances then, the super deduction, which many companies have enjoyed over the last couple of years, that was introduced as a temporary sort of post-COVID measure to encourage capital investment, that comes to an end on the 31st of March. Now that was introduced, and what it allowed for was a sort of full immediate 130% deduction against your capital expenditure. So if you spent £100 on a piece of plant, you'll get a tax deduction immediately for £130. So that was a lot of companies made use of that. That is coming to an end, but it's effectively being replaced with two things, one that was already announced and one that was new in this budget. So the annual investment allowance, which has been around for some years now and has changed in terms of its amount lots of times over the years, it's now been permanently set at £1 million per year from the 1st of April 2023. So if you are a business that consistently spends less than that, all you'll probably need to rely on in the main each year is the annual investment allowance, because that will allow you immediate tax deduction in the year of spend for anything up to £1 million of capital investment each year. The Chancellor said that will cover 99% of businesses. So for the remaining 1%, which is really what the new announcement earlier this week called full expensing, that's just actually applies to only a narrow group of companies that are spending over £1 million a year, because for the remaining 99%, it's really the annual investment allowance. So the full expensing announcements is a temporary measure that lasts for 3 years. It's only for companies, which we'll come on to, so it doesn't cover partnerships, doesn't cover sole traders, and so on. And what that will basically say is it's basically an extension to the annual investment allowance by other means, although there are some differences, like you have to buy new and unused capital items, it can't be used for secondhand items and so on. So it does have to be expenditure on new items, and that allows for a full 100% relief. Basically all your expenditure in the year on the provision of plants and machinery. So I don't know, if you're spending £5 million a year, you will get a full tax deduction of £5 million a year, as long as you're a company and as long as it's on new and unused capital expenditure. There will also be a 50% first year allowance for expenditure on the special rate pool. That was essentially the same as during the super deduction period. So that's things like integral features in buildings, like wiring, electricity, lift shafts and so on, and long life assets and other items like that. There'll obviously be some anti-avoidance provisions, which we've just mentioned there, to make sure people don't use this as a means to permanently sort of erode their tax base. I've mentioned a couple of times that it only applies to companies. So if you are a partnership, so for example, a lot of large firms of solicitors, architects, accountants, professional advisors, and you will be able to benefit from the annual investment allowance. But if you have, for example, one-off years where you're spending a significant amount on the office fit out, then you need to be careful that, the amount's over $1 million, you will just be essentially stuck in that main rate pool rates of, 18% and special rate pool of 6%, which is obviously a sort of reducing balance basis, which obviously significantly reduced and slower rate of tax deduction than being able to take it all up front. So there is a kind of, I'm sure they would have been able to do something, and we don't really know why they've restricted companies, but that is the way it is, and that is the same as it was under the super deduction as well. It was only available to companies.
Nick, I'll let you finish capital allowances, and there's a good question coming.
It's a minor point that the first year allowance on electric car charging points will continue for a further 2 years. So we can probably move straight on to your point.
It zips back a bit. So this is a return to what you and I know and love, the old associated company rules. So this is a question. We have one company with profits over 250,000. And that company has a minority shareholder who owns another company with profits under 50,000. Will the smaller company get hit with the higher rate of corporation tax, or will it still enjoy the lower rate of 19?
So it will all depend on facts and circumstances, but the associated company rules may come into effect to effectively lower the thresholds at which you have to pay tax at the higher rate of 25%. So the 250,000 threshold for paying tax at 25% will need to be reduced proportionately for the number of associated companies that you've got in your group. So if you're in a group scenario where there's a control relationship, as it sounds like there might be here, then I didn't get the full facts.
Into
paying tax at the higher rate, a lower threshold.
Yeah. So if the shareholder that's in common between the two companies only has a minority interest in one company, and has a controlling interest in the other, they wouldn't then be treated as associated.
If they just have a minority shareholding, so it's a control test. If that shareholder that's being referred to had a controlling interest in both companies, then yes, you would be hit by that. But yes, you wouldn't in the facts as you mentioned.
Yeah. So short version, you're fine, Charles. So because it's not common control.
Moving on from capital allowances, R&D. So the R&D regime is going through quite a lot of change at the moment. Quite a lot of that had been announced already, and there's some stuff earlier this week. So the large company scheme, if you're in the RDEC scheme, your credit is increasing a fair bit by 50%. So you'll get a 20% credit for R&D expenditure going forward. These are all sort of taxed. So effectively your net credit is 15% once you've taken off 25% of tax. The SME scheme is becoming less generous. So whilst the large company scheme becomes more generous, the SME scheme becomes less generous as the two schemes start to converge and put themselves more or less on an equal footing. So there'll be reductions in the rates going forward for SMEs from the 1st of April this year. And I've set out there how the amounts of the sort of symbolic as how the, particularly if you're a loss-making company that spends money on R&D, how your credit will reduce there almost by half. This was in response to the government thinking that there were lots of, whether fraudulent or overly ambitious claims, should we say, being put in by companies helped by R&D advisors who sort of had reward-based fees and were sort of overinflated claims. So the way they've decided to deal with this is to reduce the benefit of the R&D scheme all together. The government has recognised that the SME scheme is reducing, and in response to that, it said that if you're an R&D intensive business, which they've said includes businesses where they spend over 40% of their total expenditure on R&D, then the previous credit rate of 14.5% rather than the reduced rate of 10% will continue, which will effectively increase the credit if you're a loss-making company from 18.6% to 27%. So it's quite a significant level of additional relief for those businesses that are R&D intensive. And this is just an example about how the two schemes are converging. You can see I've using a similar set of numbers between the RDEC scheme and the SME scheme, that now, based on that example, now how the two bottom line numbers are becoming more and more similar once the credit is taken into account. It had been expected that if you're a UK business that spends money overseas on R&D and that hits your UK P&L, then you wouldn't be able to claim for the overseas R&D expenditure going forward from the 1st of April 2023. That's now been delayed for a year, I guess, to allow companies to get their affairs in order with respect to their overseas workers and decide what they want to do about the fact that these things are changing. But for some businesses who have significant R&D functions overseas, this will be a significant change, but it is being delayed by a year, which will be good news for many. Some things there that are being now included in the R&D guidance to now enable you to claim R&D on data licensing and cloud computing services. That's from this April. And a couple of new sets of procedures which the government is introducing as part of its efforts to reduce the level of potential fraud and inflated schemes. So you will, if you are new to the R&D, your R&D claim, and that what they mean by that is you haven't made an R&D claim within the previous 3 years, you will need to tell HMRC within 6 months of your year end that you intend to make an R&D claim, and that would be via a claim notification form. So usually you've kind of got 2 years after your year end. They're massively accelerating that if you're making your claim for the first time or haven't made one for a few years. They're also saying that for all claims made from the 1st of August, so whichever period it relates to, that an R&D claim, for it to be valid, needs to be submitted with what they're calling an additional information form. So this is an effort to sort of standardise a lot of the information that's going into R&D claims. So that's worth being aware of, because that's coming up very soon in the next few months. I mentioned that this converging towards one scheme. There's a consultation that's just closed, so we're waiting to hear. But the government has already announced that it intends to move to just one R&D scheme from the 1st of April 2024. I wouldn't be surprised if that gets extended because of the recent announcements, and that we ended up with it being a bit later. But we are expecting the R&D scheme to converge on one RDEC scheme, which, for those of you who've been SMEs historically and have made R&D claims, it's essentially a sort of flat, more of a cash grant scheme. So as I mentioned at the beginning, 20% credit on your R&D spend that then gets taxed itself. So generally, if you're a 25% taxpayer, it's 15% net 15% credit on your R&D spend. Well, we've just got a couple of minutes left. For those of you it's relevant to, there's some changes in the creative industry tax reliefs, which is a sort of offshoot, if you like, of the R&D regime. So audiovisual reliefs, so that's film, animation, high-end TV, children's television, and also video games. We're moving from almost like an SME type scheme under R&D to the RDEC scheme. So it won't be a sort of tax deduction in your tax return. It will be a credit. So similarly, a sort of tax credit, a cash credit that you'll receive, which will be taxable. The qualifying criteria will basically stay the same. And I've just set out what the credits will look like there. So animation and children's TV is a 39% credit. Once you take off the tax, it's 29.25%. Film, high-end TV and video games moving from a 34% rate, moving to a 34% rate, I should say, with a net of 25.5% once the tax is taken into account. And that is basically saying that it will come in from 2024, and there'll be a transitionary period whilst the old scheme is phased out and the new scheme is phased in. And just finishing on theatre, orchestra, museums, exhibitions and galleries, they also enjoy tax credit for their qualifying expenditure. The tax credit rates have been increased in the post-COVID period to sort of encourage people to get out more and to spend more money. on developing theatre productions or whatever. And you can see how those credit rates have increased. You can see what it was before and how they increased and how they were due to taper back down to the old levels from 2024 onwards. Those extra reliefs have been increased for a further 2 years, so it won't be till April 2026 that the credits reduced back down to their old rates. And in fact, the museum's exhibitions and galleries relief is being completely phased out from April 2026, but that's 2 years delayed from when it was expected to be phased out, which was April 2024. And this is just to mention that there was quite a lot of mention of the EU and EEA in our theatre relief regime and those other regimes, and the legislation is being amended to remove references to the EU. So it's this kind of Brexit measure to change the way in which qualifying expenditure is worked out. That, I think, is it.
I think we'll just give an extra sort of few seconds because we're more or less at time for any final questions. And whilst we're waiting to see if any come in, I shall thank Claire and Nick for their contributions and all the hard work that went into preparing that. I think the big batch of questions we're getting in from clients are around pensions, of course. General disappointment that the full expensing doesn't apply to anything other than companies. And then you can see from those last few slides and others earlier that the Brexit benefits are so far surfacing, in a lot of our tax reliefs that were extended to Europe are all being restricted back to UK only. So I think we'll see that as a trend in legislation over the next few years to come. But plenty more to come as we get more detail. We'll share that. You'll all get a feedback form. We're pathetically grateful if anybody can give us feedback. Let us know what you'd like done differently. If there's any topics you'd like to hear on in the future, if there's anything in what Nick and Claire covered that you'd like a deeper dive in, we'll be delighted to speak to you again. And maybe even in the modern world, get you into the office. So I'll wish you all a good rest of the day, and thank you for your attendance.
Thank you. Thanks very much.
Thanks. Bye. Bye.